How you configure the base of your code structure details your entry point. Your game loop, an input, is very important because your game or app sits on top of them. And I don't really like how most people do it, so I want to show you an alternative that I use all the time and that I think simplifies your code a lot. And I'm sure you'll have something to take away from this video, because it can be easily adapted to whatever your way of doing things is. This video won't go into build systems, and it can be done with anything you want. But if you also want some advice there, check out this video. Also, this video is part of the Windows API for Game Developer series. But don't worry, you don't need to have followed it. I will start where I left off, and that is day 13 in the repo, in the description. But basically, all I have here is some code, but all it does is opens a window, and here is the main loop. In your case, this can be implemented in any window framework, like GLFW for example. For the input, I'm saving it in this struct, and it allows me to easily check if a button was pressed, held or released. This is way better than having callbacks. You can do it however you want, and I will suggest an alternative at the end of the video. But check out these videos if you want to learn how I do it in my way. Okay, now we are going to refactor this code into how I like to set it up. And the first thing we'll do is to add these two new folders, game and platform. The game folder will hold your app or game logic, and the platform folder will hold the setup things like the entry point, window opening, input and main loop. Here, I would also have a folder for libraries, but more details like this can be found here. If you are interested, my CMake looks like this. I just take all the CPP files from both folders and also the header files from both of them, so it's really simple. Now, inside the game folder, I will add a new CPP and header file. Here, I will create these three functions: initGameplay, GameplayFrame, and closeGameLogic. They will be called when I create the game, once every frame, and when I close the game respectively. These two don't have any parameters, but the update will take as parameters things like the delta time, the window size, and the input. Now we need to call them. I call the init right before the main loop, but after I create the window. I call destroy after the update loop, and update inside the loop right after I configure the input. Note that init and update can return, and if they return 0, we just close the program. Also, note that when we close the program, we don't just call terminate. We exit off the main loop instead, so we can also call the closeGameLogic function before exiting. Now, here we pass the parameters for the update function. The input is already configured. The window dimensions can be obtained like this. And now for the time. The code looks like this. I just use chrono for this. I know this part is horrible, but you only need to write it once or copy it from my GitHub. I have my delta time in seconds. Note that I do this thing here, and this is to keep the delta time artificially smaller if the game lags and it becomes too big. This is to eliminate some potential bugs in the gameplay. It's up to you if you want to do this, but we'll look more at time-related stuff in another video, because we also need to limit the FPS. Now, finally, inside the game folder, I have gamelogic.cpp and gamelogic.h. Here, I have the code for the game. This should separate the game from anything platform-specific if you want this code to be cross-platform. If you do this, switching to another platform just means swapping this platform folder with the appropriate one, while the game folder remains the same. Or you can even switch to another window library, and yes, I had to do that a few times. Now, in the gameplay frame, I can just access my input. And to test things, I wrote some code to calculate the FPS. Now, to store the game's data, I can just make a static struct to store all the data. It will be all cleared when I start the game, and since it is all in one place, it's easy to keep track of what I need to save and stuff. It is also static, so it's not accessible from outside, so it won't do harm as usually global data does. Think of this like having all of this data and functions in one big class. You can also use a class if you want, but I personally just don't see the point since it would be a singleton class anyway, so I don't really have any reason to add a class and make it a singleton pattern, rather than just writing the functions in this file. But anyway, you can do this however you want. You can also add the headers in one extra file, so you access them like this. And instead of sending data like I do, you can also store it globally and create a getter for it, so you can access it like this. I recommend using my approach though, because then you can easily see which systems request input and which don't, and abstract them more easily, or even pass custom altered input to a system, or even implement input playback, as I did in my engine. But it's all up to you. So, in the next video in this series, we'll finally start drawing on the screen using pixels. So make sure you subscribe to not miss that. And also, if you found this video interesting, share it, because if it gets more views, I make videos more often. So we all win. See you!